patience. I apologize for the delay, very humbly. I also just like to start off with a little overview of what we'll be covering today. Number one will be a little bit of a summary of the walkabout feedback that we got from residents on the ground as we spent the last 8 days in Pasir Ris Kovo. We have been doing that actually much earlier onwards already, but it was intensified over the last 8 days. So the feedback that we have been getting is very, very good. In many different points, I'll be sharing that with you. I'll also take a few minutes of your time to just introduce our candidates and their age and of what they are doing, just a little quick one. But most importantly, the upcoming town council plans and some of the important things that we are going to cover that are going to help make the lives of all the residents even much better in every way. After that, we'll open the questions and you can forward all the questions to anyone or all of the candidates. So once again, I thank you so much for being here today. The first thing that I'd like to start off with, maybe, shall I wait for Calvin to join us back in, then I'll introduce the candidates, if it's okay with you. So I'm going to jump to point number two, which is the feedback from the residents. And these are some of the important things that they have all been complaining about. It's consistent. And the good news is that we reflected some of these things already in our manifestos. And the most important point was always about the spike in the high cost of living in Singapore. So residents all over Singapore, Pasir Ris, Punggol especially, they felt, and among different age groups, they have been feeling the high cost of living that has been squeezing the Singaporeans as a whole. The second thing that came on our list of complaints, I would say, is the loss of good jobs for Singaporeans. And this was very crucial. Even just a few, you can say, hours before we came and joined you for the press conference, we had the same complaint coming from one elderly gentleman. And I was speaking to him, and then Mr. Desmond was invited in to listen to him because he's one of our senior citizens. But he felt very sad because he lost his job, I think, after 30 years of being employed with good companies. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And then he felt very lost about what was happening. And I could see the real tears in his eyes. And this just happened at Pasir Ris MRT earlier, just before we came for this conference. So loss of good jobs has been the biggest, or you can say the second biggest complaint after cost of living among Singaporeans, especially the Pasir Ris Punggol residents. Number three was about CPF savings that has been a totally broken scheme. A lot of elderly people complained again that they were hoping to withdraw the funds at 55. It went up to 58, 60, and now 62. And what they are experiencing is that little payments that are coming every month may not even be enough to meet the daily and the monthly necessities of all these individuals. I'm not going into details, I'm just giving you the overview. If you have questions, we would love to answer them during the Q&A session. The fourth thing that I think was very wonderful lady, we also met her earlier, and today again, and she's also in the social service services departments of many other organizations. And she told both of us just now that the gap between those who have and have nots, it's actually widening a lot among Singaporeans. So this, I think, was not only her telling us again just now this afternoon at MRT station, but this is something that's a reality that even elderly people and young people are feeling very strongly. So these are some of the crucial feedback and the core points, the pain points that I heard and we all heard, and we compiled it together. Number five on the list would be the HDB prices. The fact that it is going to go down to zero, that is one of the very difficult pain points, because most Singaporeans says when I was younger, we were told this would be an appreciating asset, which will always go up in value. But the fact that it's going down to zero, it is going to affect the plan for retirement that most Singaporeans have. So this is one of the very, I would say, I heard it too many times at every door that we were at, and most of our fellow candidates went through this too. We'll speak about this in 2 minutes, how we plan to overcome as SDAs moving forward. Now, some of the other complaints we heard were about noise pollution that is coming from our neighboring countries. This is very important for residents that are living in the HDB blocks. Mr. Desmond may cover in detail a little bit. And this noise pollution is from the airport. Our first proposal is we can always move the Paya Lebar Airport back towards Changi as soon as possible. And we want to push for an early movement of this plane so the noise that's disturbing the residents and their rest time will not be there as much as they're going through. Next thing, also about smell coming from one of our neighboring countries. I'm not mentioning the name, but Our goal is to work with our own ministry first to try and resolve this issue of these smells that are coming through. Number two, and then work with the other governments to see how we can help our residents. Because multiple residents were talking about this smell issue that's coming up. We also have not got the right name for this, but there's some filters that we were told are available that can be put around these HDB blocks that are affected by the bad smells that are coming from the neighboring countries. So once we get the technology into place, and once we get elected into office, these will be some of the very important issues that we will be focusing on. Now, the next one may be a little bit strange because Mr. Lau is from another party and he was in parliament all this while. But a lot of our senior residents who met us, they said that there's a vacuum of a good Chinese speaker to stand up and speak for them in Chinese in parliament. The solution to that, if I can immediately say, is sitting next to me on my left, Mr. Desmond Lin speaks very good Chinese, so I might as well call that as one of our potential solutions to this vacuum that has been left by Mr. Lau. So he's well respected among a lot of other residents, also in Pasir Ris Punggol. And at the same time, if I can also mention, this morning we also met Dr. Paul Tambria, and we also met Dr. Tan. We have already covered this in the last few days. And that is to show our unitedness among the different parties of the alternative platform. We may not be going out there and speaking loud about it or doing a lot of grand gestures and waving and hand wavings to show that we are into a movement of unity among all alternative parties. But remember this, the Singapore Democratic Alliance is the only alliance in Singapore. And we believe that, yes, all alternative parties should work together and come together. And we welcome all of them, especially those who are very like-minded and who are willing to work with the same kind of principles that I'll just share in a few minutes. I'm talking about principles. Our whole alliance is based on four core values. Can I also just quickly share that since it's a related point? Number one and the foremost is always to put the country, Singapore, right at the head of every determination or any principle or any policy matter that we are coming up with. Number two is to always put the people of Singapore right at the number two point after the country. The third is to talk about the family being the unit, a healthy unit, to make sure that if all Singaporean families are healthy as a country, we will also have a wonderful, 50 years ahead, if not a good future. And of course, number four comes people like us who are willing to serve, to stand up. And people always have been asking us, again, as we knocked on doors, since I'm sharing with you the residents' feedback, a lot of them said you have lost a few times, twice in Pasir Ris Punggol. Why do you keep coming back again and again? And the consistent answer which all candidates have been putting forward is because our heart is with the people. Number two, there is this bond and a rapport that has already been built with the residents over the last 13 years with the Pasir Ris Punggol residents. The Singapore Democratic Alliance is not a fly-by-night kind of organization that will leave them to just go and go to other constituencies. We had opportunities to also put up candidates, SMCs, and also GRCs in this election. And since this is a wrap-up, may I reiterate the fact that we chose to only focus on one GRC for two major reasons. Number one, not to dilute our resources, because as a small party, yes, they are limited, all kinds of resources. But the second reason was we did not want to have three corner fights in other GRCs or SMCs amongst ourselves. It so happened we are the only GRC with a three corner fight. Everyone is welcome. Mr. Desmond and the rest may answer some of your questions on that because I know those are burning questions. But on our part, we have put up a good front in the last 8 days. Every candidate has been going on the ground from early morning 7 until late at night 11, 12. And many of you have joined us for that. I thank you for being there and covering us in the media. But the most important thing is, on our part, we have put forward all our plans for the residents of Pasir Ris Punggol. And we hope that in 2 days' time, as they go to the polls, they will give us the mandate to be the next member of parliament and represent the people, because the voice of the people is very important. And that brings me back to Mr. Low's point that some residents, especially the elderly, felt that the Chinese speaker was lacking. And Mr. Desmond Lim would be a very good alternative. I'm very sure you would agree. And talking about the core values, it brings me also to a very important point. How did we choose our candidates? And five things were very important. Mr. Desmond has emphasized this, and since we are talking about unity among different parties coming together, these are five important things we look forward to, and we will use these as our guiding light in serving the residents for the next 5 years, if not 15, if not 50 years. And the five things are, number one, we looked through our candidates to make sure they have a heart for the people. That is the first and the foremost. And number two, those who will love their job full-time if possible and will do it at full-time to serve the residents. Number two, we have always been looking for good, reliable people who we can rely on. Even at midnight, whatever time, whatever duty calls, they will be there. And they have proven over the last 8 days also, especially, and since we've been working together, to be very reliable candidates. And we are very happy to have all of them on board. Number three is, we have been looking for people who can be trusted in every way, and that is important. Number four, integrity is very high up on that scale. And number five, the most important, kindness, serving the people from the heart. So I'd like to thank all the candidates who have joined us, and I will take this minute to also introduce before I end off with the last few complaints we've been having. Of course, sitting next to me is Mr. Lim Bak Chuan. He's a principal engineer, 53 years old. Wonderful. He's also the chairman and, of course, the Secretary General of Singapore Justice Party and chairman of the Singapore Democratic Alliance. Also on my left, we have Mr. Abu Muhammad, 69 years old. He's a director in a private company and also PKMS Secretary General.
President,
I'm so sorry. Sorry, sir. Mr. Abu Muhammad, and his seniority has been very helpful in helping guiding us, and we look forward to more wisdom from him. Of course, I have on my right Mr. Kelvin Ong Soon Hua, 34 years old. He's an operations manager in a town council currently. So his experience in running these town councils is going to be very beneficial, and I'd like to reassure the residents in Pasir Ris Punggol that not only Mr. Kelvin's current experience, but the experience of Mr. Desmond Lim when Mr. Chiang Sitong was running Potong Pasir, that experience of running a town council, because he was the right-hand man of Mr. Chiang Sitong, will come in very useful. And this was a question that was raised even at NUS by the chairman, that if one of the other parties had issues with town council, what makes you very comfortable? And we are very confident that the Pasir Ris Punggol Town Council will be well taken care of with the experience of these two gentlemen who are sitting on my left and right. And also, on the extreme left, we have Mr. Kushwadi B. Atwani. He's 57 years old, and he's an electrical engineer. I'd like to thank you, and I can tell you this much. He's going on the ground, speaking and mingling with all the residents and sharing what our manifestos are, what we are standing up for, has been very helpful. And I look forward to all five candidates, including myself. I'm Hamender Pal Singh, CEO and founder, Helping People Succeed, 48 years old. And I look forward to be of service to all of Singapore, especially Pasir Ris Punggol residents. And to end off this session on the problems that we got on feedback from the residents, the next one is very important: the basic healthcare need of all Singaporeans. It is the government duty, and a lot of individuals, especially those who are self-employed, those who are like taxi drivers, the entrepreneurs, and the small businessmen, complained about the fact that to renew their license, they had to top up 6,000 into the MediSaves before it could be given to them. And to quote Mr. Desmond, he said, "This is their rice bowl. How can such a policy be in place that kicks the rice bowl of common Singaporeans?" And that is an important thing that came up. So we should not tie these regulations together. Next thing, the other complaint we heard from a lot of residents, and this would be very high in the list of complaints, was that one of the ladies in white from the outgoing incumbent party calculated a figure of $23,000 that an average Singapore should have got from the 100 billion that was drawn over the four budgets that were released in the last 100 years. So a lot of, you can say, residents were using the tagline, "Touch your heart, ask yourself, why is my bank account not showing that balance?" Which was one of the taglines you may have heard throughout the week our candidates were using all the time. Because we talk and we speak from the heart. And maybe this is one very important reason we need alternative voices to be in parliament, to question them about accountability, because as long as there are no accountability speakers or people to ask for this, we will never have the right answers. So this was one beautiful message and the feedback from the ground. The next one may be a very touchy topic, but it's a sad one, which is to do with our national servicemen who have passed on during national service. We had residents in Pasir Ris Punggol saying they still do not know which minister and which officer has been held accountable. Again, it links back to the concept of accountability, and this is very important. Next thing may be also very important to do with the lower income Singaporeans. The minimum sum to withdraw their CPF is increasing. It is linked back to the CPF policy, and they are saying with their lower income, it is very difficult for these Singaporeans to even meet the minimum sum requirements, especially the lower income families. So we like to raise this in Parliament too, because I think this is very important. In the words of one of them, "I'd rather die than fall sick and be hospitalized." You have been hearing this, and they are fearful that they will never get to see their CPF in their lifetime. So this is very important. Finally, the linking point to this is about foreign worker levies. Now, you may be surprised, all this together in 8 days, it is a lot of feedback from residents, but it is a reflection of the pain of Singaporeans, why it is so important that we need to have alternative voices in Parliament. Because the next one is to do with foreign worker levies. We pay $600 as their salary, another $600 to $700 for their levy and their lodging. That comes to a total of $1,300 to $1,400. Residents in Pasir Ris Punggol are saying, why can't a minimum salary of local Singaporeans also be tagged to that similar amount? So maybe the displaced Singaporeans who have lost their jobs can get a potential job in return, even in the lower rungs. Having said that, on the PMET side, the biggest concern they have been having is all the foreigners who have come in. And if you have studied our manifesto, that is one of the key points that we are going to raise to make sure there are better and fair policies enacted to give our well-qualified Singaporeans a better opportunity to get the jobs rather than having a lot of PMETs replace them. Please note again, we have said it many a times, we are not against foreign workers coming, especially those who are helping in jobs that Singaporeans are not taking up. But we are against those PMET jobs, especially the ones that can be done by our very educated, well-qualified Singaporeans. And we need them to be given the first priority. And towards the end, I've got three more points which are very important. And if I missed any, the rest of the candidates will help you cover this. These three points have to do with the lease of HDB, which I spoke about earlier. The cash is tied up. And number two, most importantly, about the COVID mandate. And there are two points on COVID-19. One of the residents actually not just spoke at length, he gave us a lot of feedback on the phone. And in this election, I would say as much as walking the ground was very important, in this COVID election, we also realized our social media outreach was very, very important. And a lot of members of the residents of that area have been having long conversations on phone because they have a lot of feedback that they want to give us. One of them actually sent us video and also photographs, which we all have them if ever needed. He wants to be anonymous because he says during the COVID-19, quarantine centers were set up in Pasir Ris Punggol and Loyang Point. And residents there are very, very tired of the fact that no consultation or not even any advice was given when they had these centers set up in that area. So Loyang Point on one side and Pasir Ris Park, both where our residents are very concerned. And these residents who have videos, they have noticed a lot of guards without masks, and they said there were back entrances where they saw people who were on quarantine escaping out and moving out, and their wives also witnessed these things. So their main concern was the safety of our own local Singaporeans if quarantine centers are set up so close to their residents. Number one, they should be advised. Number two, more security should be set up in such a way that the quarantined individuals don't leave, and so that there is no more a second spread of the COVID-19. And having said this, brings me to the last point, feedback from residents. It is on COVID-19. The ministers of the outgoing party, they have asked us for our plans on the post-COVID-19 period. And if you studied our manifesto in detail and also listened to some of the online rallies, we have covered more than 20 different going forward action points. And as Mr. Desmond Lim says, the people gave the mandate, and I repeat his words because I think those are important words. The people gave the mandate to the outgoing government 4.5 years ago, they were supposed to be responsible for making sure Singaporeans are well taken care of and we recover from this pandemic before calling for an election. They have called for an election. It is irresponsible, what we said earlier, 9 months ahead of the end of the term. And instead of them coming out with solutions that would have put the lives of Singaporeans first, they are in fact asking us. But not to worry, we also have good plans. We need your support. This Friday, do the right thing. Put us in office and we will be there to speak up for all Singaporeans, especially residents of Pasir Ris Punggol. If I missed out on any of the feedback, we will please help each other out. Yes? Yeah. Okay, and I come back to the last now. How are we going to help make the lives of all Singaporeans better? And this section was to help you understand what are the benefits of also bringing us into Parliament this term. The very first thing is very important. We're going to ask for the return of the full CPF once we reach the retirement age. We're going to, of course, keep a little sum in their MediSave and MediShield to make sure their healthcare is taken care of because we are a responsible party. But the promise was that the money will be returned at 55. Now it has gone to 62. We need that money back so that our senior citizens can live a life of dignity in their last final years of retirement. Very first important point that we're going to push for. Number two, we're going to ask for an extra 1% to 5% of the net returns on the investments of the government. Why? Because social inequality is rising in Singapore and even the lower rungs of our own community don't have an equal starting point. So to give them a good starting point, we are proposing 1% to 5%. And last year, just for your information, $17 billion were the net returns that Singapore had. This year, it's expected to be $18.6 billion. Taking a small fraction of just 1 to 5% is going to go a long way into helping our own fellow Singaporeans, especially those in Pasir Ris Punggol. Number three, we want to push for the irresponsible spending on extravagant projects to be stopped because this is very important. The cost of living is going up. To bring it down, the savings will be helpful to all Singaporeans. In fact, on that link, on that same point, GST is proposed to be cut to 3%. And I slow down there because no other party, no one is talking about GST being cut except the Singapore Democratic Alliance. We're going to ask that it be reduced to 3%, especially for food, common household items, and the necessities that all Singaporeans need, because these savings are important due to the cost of living. And last but not least, in this four that I'm mentioning, and then I'll bring back to the last grand finale, is to have something new for you. Number three is to tighten the control on immigration and to enact fair labor policies so that talented Singaporeans can get good jobs. Now, a lot of residents were also complaining about the fact that fake degrees and things like that. We are proposing to have an accreditation system that is coming out from Singapore itself to make sure foreign universities are accredited and only those people who have those degrees get a job in Singapore to make sure that our Singaporeans have a first chance. Now, one of the best things that as I end today's sharing with you, this is a future plan which you would not have heard from any other parties in any part of Singapore. And that is a revolution on power generation. In a small country with limited resources, cost of living going up and power bills going up, a lot of residents were complaining about the S&C charges too. So we are introducing, when elected, a special revolutionary power generation system that is going to be very green power oriented for the residents in Pasir Ris Punggol. This is one of the world's latest innovation. And I have the good news. It uses liquid water kind of system and air to create special, special air pressures to push the movement of energies and create power. Now, this has already been tested in our neighboring countries. Number two, this technology has already been patented. And number three, it has shown and proven to give up to 50% savings for the bills of power for residents. So elected, this would be one of our first implementations to make sure the power bills come down, there are savings. And then our residents were asking us, so what will you use the savings for? And the good news is, we will use the savings to first help the aging population. You may not have heard of this, but in Pasir Ris Punggol, over the last 5 years especially, we have served more than 3.5 million daily lunches. Elderly people are left behind by their children who go to work. And when they come back home, then elderly people go out. So we're going to be setting up special corners where they can actually hang around, free citizens, senior citizens corner, where they can just spend the time together with their fellow senior citizens, maybe even get a massage, mingle, have toilet facilities, because I think at that age they need to live a life of dignity. Also, the savings will be forwarded towards anger and stress management corner. Today, the life in Singapore is very stressful. A lot of young people come back angry. They go home, it is going to spread the anger to the family. We rather they stay at our special corners, get de-stressed, let go of the anger before they go home. So this is important. And number three, for the young, we not only plan to help them with their academics from the savings that they're going to get, but also give them good enrichment programs, especially programs that are going to help them survive in the post-COVID-19 economy. The whole world is changing, and we are looking forward to helping these young people excel in the next stages of the post-COVID recovery and after the recovery period. And the last but not least, this may be something unique. There are a lot of residents who we met on the ground who have actually been displaced, lost their jobs, or they have had to take a pay cut. Now, especially for these residents in Pasir Ris Punggol who are healthy enough, who are willing to take a second job, our town council is proposing to give them an opportunity to work with us, the Pasir Ris Town Council, so that they can actually have enough salaries. And number two, they can also offset their SNC charges. And most importantly, the benefit to the town council is instead of paying hefty contractors to do the same work, maybe our local residents can also play a part, thus bringing down the cost and helping bring in more savings. Now that brings me to the end of the presentation on the problems we got from the residents and also some of the solutions and innovative solutions we have. I will now like to open the floor for questions, and all speakers are ready for your questions. Thank you so much for your attention.
Any questions? Can you just elaborate on, you mentioned about the HDB and how the prices are.